Greetings. Thanks for reading my first letter, brother. I know you have some serious thinking to do to understand the impact of what the prophets said about Jesus. The next question you sent me was about the begotten Son of God. It's drastic shame to claim that God have took begotten Son just like how human animals do. This is a thing that animals do, not God. Why would God need to populate? And it is clear from his question that he is thoroughly inculcated and inoculated by the Islamic polemic. This is a thing that animals do. Brother, as in my first letter, you need to read and respect what the prophets have said. You also need to think maturely about the concept God is attempting to communicate to you and mankind. So what did the prophets and apostles of God reveal, brother? Psalm 2:7, I will declare the decree the Lord hath said unto me, Thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. Prophet David said what God wanted him to say. God wanted David to reveal a future event when God spoke of his begotten son. John 1:14, And the Word, meaning the Word of God, was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Jesus was the Word of God made into flesh. And the interesting thing, brother, is that Jesus existed before he entered into flesh. Hebrews 10:5. For this reason the scriptures say, when the Messiah was about to come into the world, you did not want sacrifices and offerings, but you prepared a body for me. And where did this come from? Psalm 46, you were not pleased with sacrifices and offerings. You have dug out two ears for me. You did not ask for burnt offerings or sacrifices for sin. Then I said, Behold, I have come. In the scroll of the book it is written of me. So Prophet David revealed the coming of someone for whom God prepared a body. That same person said the scriptures were written about him. John 1:18, No man has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. God wanted to be revealed to man, but no man has ever seen God. Do you think maybe God knew he needed to do something out of the ordinary? Think about that, brother. Can Almighty God know something you and I do not know? John 3:16, For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. His gift was to be a sacrifice to pay for the sins of all mankind, because the blood of bulls and goats would not satisfy God. Hebrews 9:13, The blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkled on those who were ceremonially unclean sanctified them so that they were outwardly clean. You see, the sacrifice of bulls and goats, which God required, made them clean outside, my friend. But it was not enough. It did not satisfy God, as Prophet David said. Psalm 46, You were not pleased with sacrifices and offerings. Hebrews 9:14, How much more, therefore, will the blood of the Messiah, who by the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify your conscience from dead works that we may serve the living God? So remember, we are talking about the begotten Son of God, and why did God need to send his begotten Son? Acts 13:32, And we declare unto you glad tidings, how that the promise which was made unto the fathers, God has fulfilled the same unto us their children, in that he has raised up Jesus again, as it is also written in the second psalm, Thou art my Son, this day have I begotten thee. You see, brother, I know that teachers of Islam claim Prophet David in Psalms 2 spoke only of himself. But as you can see, the disciples, good Muslims who followed Jesus, they knew that Prophet David spoke of Messiah, the begotten Son of God. And the hang-up of the word begotten comes from Islam's incorrect understanding of the term. The Apostle Paul used that term multiple times when he was speaking of people he birthed into the true faith in God. 1 Corinthians 4:15, "For though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet have you not many fathers. For in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel." Philemon 1:10, "I beseech thee for my son Onesimus, whom I have begotten in my bonds." A mature understanding of the term does not carry a childish sexual connotation. But let's consider one more confirmation about Psalms 2, "This day have I begotten thee," speaking of Jesus. Hebrews 1:5, "For unto which of the angels said he, God, at any time, Thou art my Son, this day have I begotten thee? And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son." We know this comes from Psalms 2. But where does this come from in the message of the prophets? "I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son." 2 Samuel 7:14, "I will be his father, and he will be my son." Hebrews 5:5, "So also Christ glorified not himself to be made a high priest, but he God that said unto him, Thou art my Son, today have I begotten thee." Over and over we see the term begotten and only begotten applied to Jesus by the apostles and prophets. And this is one reason God required Abraham to offer up his only son, Isaac. Genesis 22:2, "And he said, Take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of." Hebrews 11:17, "By faith Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac, and he that had received the promises offered up his only begotten son." And I understand the uncomfortable emotions that passage causes the descendants of Ishmael, brother. But it is God who called and considered Isaac Abraham's only begotten son. This is why God required Abraham to sacrifice Isaac, the heir of the first covenant. Would Abraham sacrifice his only begotten son to ratify the covenant? Because for God to ratify the second covenant, he would have to sacrifice his only begotten son. Now I've shown you, brother, the consistent teaching of being begotten, and specifically of the prophets and apostles revealing Jesus was begotten of God. I'd now like to share with you the mystery of the gospel, which Jesus could not share with his disciples before he left. Remember, Jesus said, "I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come." Well, the Comforter, the Holy Spirit of God, whom Jesus sent to the disciples, revealed the following. 1 Peter 1:3, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again into a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." The God of Abraham wants to give us a new birth into life. Not just turning over a new leaf, as in changing habits and actions and behaviors. 1 John 4:9, "In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him." That we as Christians might live through him. We might receive our life from him. 1 John 5:1, "Whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. And everyone that loveth him that begat, loveth him also that is begotten of him." Now we need to look closely at that, brother, because being a Muslim, you have been taught some confusing falsehoods. It says, "Whosoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God." Notice this word is born, meaning begotten and fathered, not B-O-R-N-E, as in transported, carried, conveyed, or motivated. Think what that means, brother, and remember, Jesus could not reveal this mystery before he left. 1 John 5:18, "We know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not, but he that is begotten of God keeps himself, and that wicked one touches him not." This answers the challenge you have been taught, and I can write more of it in my next letter, brother. Remember when you taunt me, claiming Christians think we can sin freely and expect forgiveness? I'll cover that more in a future letter. Romans 8:29, "For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren." This is truly a mystery, brother, that Jesus, being the only begotten Son, might be the firstborn of many brothers. But it will all make sense when you understand that God adopts all who want to become his sons and daughters. When Jesus taught Nicodemus about being born again, this is what the Messiah was speaking about. John 3:3, "Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." But Nicodemus did not understand being born again. So Jesus had to clarify and expand what he said. John 3:5, "Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." It is being born of the Spirit of God which those who become Christians experience, brother. But as I said, this is a mystery, and even in the Christian church world, too many do not understand being born again. 1 Peter 1:23, "Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever." The seed which gives birth in the hearts of Christians, brother, is the word of God, the Bible. Can you see now, brother, why Islam wants you to accept that the word of God has been corrupted? If you can be convinced the word of God is corrupted, you will not plant the words of life in your heart. Even as the word of God declares it is incorruptible, meaning it cannot be corrupted, brother. Hebrews 4:12, "For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart." It is impossible, brother, for the word of God to become powerless. Isaiah 55:11, "So shall my word be that goes forth out of my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it." And that verse, brother, opens a topic for another whole letter after you digest this one. But maybe now, my Muslim brother, you may begin to taste the glory of the mystery which God had planned from the beginning of creation. Revelation 13:8, "And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. You see, Jesus, who is called the Lamb of God, was considered slain before God made the universe. And if Satan had any idea of God's plan, he would not have killed Jesus on the cross. 1 Corinthians 2:7, "But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory." His plan was always that believers would be redeemed from sin and born again. 1 John 4:7, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loves is born of God and knows God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love." And this, brother, is why we see so many Christians not showing God's love. They have not taken time to get to know God. But they are still born again of the incorruptible seed of the Word of God. I hope, brother, that you have begun to understand that Jesus is the begotten Son of God. And the term begotten is not an animal sexual concept, as those who do not grasp the mystery have fooled themselves to believe. God's plan was to beget tons of sons, born again of His Spirit, by the seed of the Word of God, which cannot be corrupted. And brother, do you want to be welcomed in as a son of God? Does your heart cry out from an emptiness to meet the God of heaven and earth? God wants to manifest this mystery in your heart, brother. Recognize that Jesus is the firstborn because God gives Him a special place of honor. Colossians 1:18, "And He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things He might have the preeminence." Please ask if you have any questions, brother. And may the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.